Welcome back to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson's Sorcery. The Let's Play, hopefully you can't see this up here. This thing, the share thing, works weird with this game. Sometimes you can see things like down here. Sometimes you can see the mouse pointer, you can see. Sometimes this appears, sometimes it's not. I think during dialogue it appears. And sometimes you can see the banner up here, share your gameplay, all this stuff. I don't know why. Anyway, this is the Let's Play where you, well, it's interactive. At the end of the video, you can choose what you would like for me to do next. Last time it was unanimous. For some reason, everyone said, go left. So I'm going to go left. We are looking for the last noble to get his spell line. We found Shinva, we found Tira. Sansas? Mulas. Living corpse. Okay, music, thank you. Music is very loud for some reason. So we're looking for Mulas, who we're hoping is around here somewhere. I might have gone this way. You follow a group of youngsters with packs up the road. Homes, hovels line the track, and strange faces appear at the windows, watching you as you pass. Then, from around the bend ahead, a troop of guards appears. Maybe we haven't been this way. So as you can see, we have no gold. I did lose a point of stamina because I keep rewinding to go back, which is a spell that Lorag casts on me, I believe, to go back in time. It's pretty much like the most impressive, like as far as multimedia capability of this, the whole thing rewinds and you see your steps being retraced backwards and the music being played backwards. So we have no gold, unfortunately, but we have two rations, which is awesome. Let's dart into a nearby hut, I guess, for cover. Maybe we'll find Mulas. Inside is dark, with a smell of rotting straw rising from a pile of mattresses that circle a low table. It is only after a moment that you realize these mattresses are occupied. I need a drink. My throat's a little scratchy. Three ugly faces peer at you through clouds of smoke rising from a hookah pipe that sits on the table. They're ugly, I'm guessing, and they smoke. Examine the people. You look at the three creatures who are staring at you with lazy disinterest. They are the Black Elves, normally clever and vicious creatures, but these three only stare vacantly into the clouds of smoke at the top of the hut. Well, they're all obviously high. I'll smell the air. You sniff the air tentatively and your head spins. The smoke of the hookah is sweet and stupefying. It is weed plant. That explains the lethargy of the three elves. One of the elves takes a long draw on the hookah pipe, then sighs and settles back on his mattress. Talk to them. You turn to the nearest elf and nod. Greetings, you say. The elf nods back in return. I want to ask for your help. The elf nods deeply in reply. I've been sent by the first noble. The elf nods a third time, more profoundly now. I'm on a vital mission. The elf nods once more. It is only then that you realize he is asleep. This is useless. The smokers are too confused and vague. They're so vague, they're not even conscious. Try something else? Enough talking. You look around the hut once more. What if I sit and draw on the hookah? You gesture to the nearest elf, asking for permission to sit down beside him. He does not even notice you. Putting the pipe to your mouth, you breathe in a cloud of sweet, apple-tasting smoke. You begin to feel lightheaded. Weed plant affects different people in different ways, and you cannot be sure what it will do to you. As you wait to find out, you find yourself staring up into the clouds. Shapes seem to form themselves. There. Is that a dragon? Or a milk jug? I'm staring into the clouds. I guess there's no roof to this place. It's a dragon. Snapping at an old man smoking a pipe, or is that a young girl dancing in a wide billowing dress? It's a girl. A dancing girl, yes, of the kind you saw in the king's court before you left for the settlement. Perhaps those girls are dancing even now. Perhaps the one you see above you is the one who twirls before the king so very far away from here. The smoke makes you feel sleepy, and you doze for 20 minutes, awaking with a slight headache. One of the elves starts coughing. The others look at him with surprise, but then their attention wanders away once more. Okay, well, so, nothing's happened. We still have our food, we still have our stamina, and we didn't have any gold to begin with, so... When you fall asleep or don't pay attention to this game, yeah, you gotta check your stuff. Well, I gotta check my items, right? The atmosphere is putrid. You check through the doorway to see that the guards have gone, and go straight back into the fresh air, and then continue up the street. Yeah, they'll be hanging around for quite a while if they're, like, for 20 minutes and they're just hanging around here. So we had those. I don't think we're missing anything. You continue up the narrow road. It is packed either side with mud brick hovels, but most are deserted. A few creatures pass by, heads turned down. They do not look at you. This part of the city port is barely habited and certainly not somewhere the nobles would be found, but you may be able to learn some useful information from inhabitants all the same. You pass a drinking fountain dribbling water into a chipped stone bowl. Okay, if we drink from the fountain, we usually get our stamina increased. You lean down by the fountain to cup your hand to drink. The water tastes cool, if herbal. Perhaps something is growing in it. Well, that worked. Okay. You swallow boldly. If the fountain is running on a busy street like this, it can't be too poisonous. In fact, the water seems quite fresh, and you swallow a few more mouthfuls, finding you had not realized how thirsty you were. The dust of the city streets and the baking heat has been tiring you out, but you feel somewhat refreshed. Stop a creature to talk. You stop a stooped orc-like creature. The Shrine of Slang. I'm looking for the nobles of the city. If you find them, the creature replies, tell them we need... never mind. There's no use in it. The nobles don't listen? Thieves and villains. That's how we elect them. The creature replies, so I don't know why we should be surprised when they steal money from the city to build bigger houses for themselves. That must make you angry. The creature shrugs. I don't feel very angry. It must be something in the water that keeps us quiet. The creature looks somewhat uncomfortable to be talking to you. Huh. What's the Shrine of Slang? At once the creature seems to brighten up. I love slang, he answers, with genuine enthusiasm, although I've been there once a week for the last year and never seen anyone attempt the impossible question. I'd love to see that. What's the impossible question? Exactly. I have no idea. I've been told it's never been asked. That's the whole idea. It's a question with an answer, but one that's never asked. The quiet creature shakes its head. I tell you, if I could have a try, I would, but I don't dare. Okay, I'm heading for the north gate. The creature nods sadly. The north gate. I heard about that once. What did you hear? Oh, I don't know. I think maybe they took it down, but then I've never been able to afford to cross the river. What else can you tell me about it? I don't know. The creature answers, thinking hurts my head. Excuse me, I have to be going. With that, he shuffles away. There's nothing else to do here. You continue up the road. Well, we are heading farther and farther away from lower... It's lower Kharé we're supposed to be in. So if I start finding familiar territory, guys, like, this would be, like, from the beginning of the game, I'm guessing. What's this? That's a very good question. I've never been here. Have I? Don't think so. Well, we gotta go there. I'm pretty sure I came out and went this way. Yeah, see? You can see where I went. I have never been up this way. Huh. I might end up rewinding, because I do want to find this moolass. A little further on the road approaches the first stone building you have seen since the hut by the gates. It has windows of glass and a wide yard inside its uneven, high wall. Whoever lives here is wealthy and understandably cautious. They have, however, left a fine stallion only loosely tied up outside. Hmm. You approach the horse. It snorts nervously, wary of your presence. You might be able to calm it or even talk to it with the correct spell. Do I have a communicate, like, talk to animals spell? I have charm animal. I don't think that would be it. Just checking, guys. To me, those are among the most interesting spells in a fantasy setting to me, to be able to communicate with animals. Because if it's done realistically, or what you think would be realistically, speak with animal. We need the green-haired wig for that. We had two opportunities possibly to get that. In... where was it? I just come out of this. The Festival of Thieves, there was a guy in there with a green-haired wig. And I didn't realize it. And he was supposed to, like, tell your fortune or something, but he didn't do anything. And then the noble... where is he? Here. Lorag. He put a green-haired wig on me and charmed me, and I was... became his pet or assistant or whatever like that for the rest of my life. So I do not have that spell. You try a few words in the common tongue and then a few whispered in the more gentle language of your girlhood in Charberry Wood. The animal listens with its ears cocked, giving you a strange, distant look. But of course it does. It is a horse. Still, it seems calmer in your presence now. Perhaps you've made a friend. What if I try to read its mind instead, because I have that skull cap? See if they have the option. Nope. It's T-E-L. And I have H, Y, and S. Right. So I can basically cast a fireball at it. Nice. Nice game. Yaz? What the hell is Yaz spell? I've never used it, that's for sure. Yaz or Yap? Oh, Yap must be that... Yap is speak with animal. Yaz is invisibility. I guess to help me steal the horse. So it looks like the horse is running off by itself. Pretty cool. I don't think I should steal the horse. I don't think I can make it through the city with this horse, in any case. And what else? S? Sap? Sap. I'm so glad I wrote all these down, guys. Foe loses morale. Yeah, that's really, yeah. Wait, wait. S U or S U S. S U S. Where is that? Now I have to, like, put them in alphabetical order, right? Detect trap. Nah. I'm gonna leave it. You do not need a horse and carry anyway, so you step away from the horse and leave it to itself. Let's go to the house. Hopefully Mulas is here or they know something about Mulas. You step through the gate of the house into its wide front yard. It was once a magnificent place, with fish ponds, now stagnant, fountains, now cracked and dry, and small groups of quiet trees, now overgrown and gnarled like whispering old men. The building itself has fared no better. One side has collapsed in on itself completely, and the other leans perilously to one side. Now, you know what I wonder? The four nobles. Right, so we have... this Lorag. Because this is very similar, isn't it? To this. This might be Shinva's old place, which is in disrepair because... well, he's dead. I hope he can come out and go in here. And maybe here. That'd be awesome. And I'm just looking to see if there's any other... really more... oh, shut up, dog. Maybe here is another? I'm not completely sure that these are places you can actually go. Just keep in mind. Or it could be what's-his-name? Theta, who became homeless. Maybe he was dragged out of this home for some reason. Look in the trees, approach the building, look at the fountains. I guess this is closest. You pause to look around in the trees and shrubs when you notice the two gleaming eyes staring back at you. A giant bat hangs upside down from one of the branches watching you. If I don't have to fight it, I'll pass it by. I guess I have to fight it. You hold the bat stare for another moment, then walk on. But the rustling in the leaves behind you is pretty clear, and you spin around in time to see the creature coming for you with its talons drawn. You draw your sword quickly and engage the creature. Alright, start with a bold move then. I didn't even have to do that much. The bat's great wings buffet at your face, making it hard to see. You swing out wildly, hoping to chop it from the sky, as the bat dodges back, cutting with the hooks on its wingtips. You know, I gotta tell you something, guys, about this game. This is the most interestingly written, like, fight. Like, I don't know, it's the fight written out, you know, in dialogue. Not dialogue, but, you know. You know what I mean. It's very descriptive. Nice. Another chance follows. You cleave the air with your sword, catching the giant bat wide open. The bat is flying erratically now. It flutters upwards. I just barely won. Cool! The creature is now afraid. You cut a sideways blow. The bat falls to the ground, and the light in its eyes goes dark. No stamina lost. Flawless fighting. Wow. Best ever. You turn to face the house once more. Yeah, this was the best combat ever. Or, like, you know, the best I've done. Too bad we don't get gold and stuff from these things. You know, in what average fantasy game, you fight a, you know, a rat and you get gold. I guess you pulled it out of its rectum or something. I don't know where these animals have gold, but somehow you get gold and stuff. The front door is... sometimes you get rings and other things. It's crazy. The front door is as wide as two men and stands imposingly sealed. A small path winds around the back of the house. Okay, so we can go back to the main junction, go to the door, or go to the path. There's also stuff back here, but we don't have an option to go there. You stride up the steps to the door of the grand house. Knock on the door. You walk up to the door and knock, just to make sure. No one answers. Ooh. You knock a second time, louder. As you wait to see if you will be answered, you notice a curious detail. There are deep grooves carved into the wood of the door, radiating outwards from the keyhole. It's as though something had exploded out through it, or perhaps attached itself on the outside to force its way in through the lock. A slate skitters off the roof and smashes itself on the ground to one side of you. Look through the keyhole. You drop to your knees and put your eye to the keyhole. At first you can see nothing, and then the darkness inside begins to take shape. You make out a long, lonely hallway running back into the house. The walls are lined with framed pictures and the surfaces with expensive ornaments. It doesn't look like the house has been emptied at all. A wooden rail runs along the inside of the hallway. Try the door. You try the door. Locked, of course. A cool wind moves through the trees in the yard, making evil whispering sounds. Okay, where's our knock spell? Knock is dop. Most of these spells are, you know, D&D equivalent. But a locked door is of no consequence. Once you have woven your spell, the great oak door complains once and then gives way, swinging open to reveal a dark hallway beyond.
Cool.
Mulas, show yourself. You step inside the great stone house. A cold silence descends, quite different from the dusty heat outside. This place feels like it has not been lived in for decades, although judging by the lack of dust, it might not have been quite so long. Floorboards creak underfoot. At the end of the hallway is a sealed door. Is that a chink of light just visible beneath the frame? Look at the light. The light beneath the door flickers, now bright, now faint, as though a figure paced back and forth, its shadow coming and going. But you hear no footsteps. Creep forwards. You make your way along the corridor. The walls on either side are lined with large portraits of dusty-looking men and sour-faced women who sneer at you as you pass. Look at the paintings. The figures in the paintings are all finely dressed, but they also have knife scars on their faces and nicks in their ears. These must be the thief kings of Kharé's murky past. You pass a large metal coal scuttle sitting along the left-hand wall. Well, look in it. You stop to look inside the scuttle, but the inside is blackened, and in the darkness it seems as though an infinitely deep pit was contained inside. Do I dare put my hand inside? You are not afraid. You reach into the scuttle, blind. The scuttle feels empty. Then your finger touches something sharp, so sharp it stings. I haven't lost stamina quick. Maybe it's a sword. Or some kind of magical dagger. Search for the sharp thing. Yes, I dare. Oh, we lost stamina. You feel around the scuttle, searching for an object. Then you find it, earning another sharp prick. You keep feeling around, and you have a clear sense that something is climbing up your arm to your wrist. What is it? Oh, God. In the darkness, you see nothing, so you grope about with your other hand to try and work out what the creature is, but you feel a stinging pain in your other hand, and a moment later you feel the same biting sensation on your neck. That's when you realize there's something wrapped around your hands as well, a snake. Kill it! You make to raise your sword and kill the beast, but it has wrapped yourself tightly around your wrists, and now you cannot move your arms at all. You've had enough of this torture in the dark. You race out of the house and back into the sunshine. What? No, I must explore. You don't understand. As you hit the light, the creature hisses and rears back and drops into the shadow. It must be a dark snake, A creature whose bite is luckily non-poisonous, just itchy. Oh, I like that name. Dark Snake. That'd be a cool name, right? It is I, Dark Snake. I turn to the house. You took a moment to collect yourself, then you step back into the darkness of the corridor, determined not to leave the house unexplored. Well, damn it, I was looking for, like, magic items, weapons. You reach the far end of the hall. It is only a short way from the entrance, but all is now in shadow. The only light comes from the gap around the frame of the door in front of you. More darkness wells up to the right. You can just make out the first few steps of a flight of stairs leading away upwards to the second level of the house. So we can leave, obviously, or go climb the stairs or enter the study. Let's enter the study. Is this where we saw the light? You push open the door and enter a wide paneled room with a thick carpet. It is a study of some kind. The source of the light under the doorframe becomes quickly apparent. A roaring fire burns in an enormous grate on one side of the room. Well, so this place isn't deserted. Look around. You search around the room. The furniture is grand, carved and stained and inlaid with patterns of goblin bone. But there are no possessions to be seen. No ornaments, no jewels, no treasure, and no sign of the owner. It is as if whoever lived here had moved out, or more likely as though the place had been thoroughly robbed. With the door shut, you expect this room to be swelteringly hot, but just like the rest of the house, it is icy cold. Well, so you moved out and left the fire going. Let's check out this fire. It's cold fire, right? You go over to the fire to warm your hands, only to find it emits no heat at all. It burns no fuel, either. The enormous grate, large enough to roast a whole boar, is entirely empty of wood, ash, or coal, but the flames are nonetheless brilliant and as high as a man. Look into the flames. Peering deeper at the base of the fire, you see there is definitely nothing burning there. The flames spring into life a finger's width above the grate. They're so bright you can make out nothing beyond, but it seems the hearth goes back some distance. We're going in, okay. Stealing your courage, you duck your head and step into the grate. The flames surround you, their crackles whispering in your ears as though you stood in a pit of snakes. But you feel no heat. Your skin does not blister, and your clothing does not ignite. You stand in the middle of a fire like some kind of demon, and feel no ill effects at all. I like that. From here you can see that the hearth extends backwards much further than you might expect. Is it a tunnel, or do you stand inside a trap, its jaws about to spring shut? Eh, we dare. Go forward. You creep forward across the grate, through the flames and beyond, into a low stone alcove hidden by the fire. The walls are made of solid slabs of stone, and there is nothing here. No treasure, no secret doors. On the far wall are a strange set of markings, a series of long grooves like scratches radiating outwards from a small hole. Feel the grooves in the far wall. You run your fingers through the grooves in the stone wall. They are a lot like the grooves you saw around the keyhole at the front door. They have been carved lightly and roughly with a dagger point rather than a chisel, perhaps, but the small hole at their center is much more cleanly formed. Examine the small hole. You put one finger into the small hole. You cannot find the bottom of it, and it seems polished and smooth. It looks like the bolt hole you might find in the stonework of a fortress doorway, except for its position in the middle of a blank wall. A keyhole? You look through your pack for something to use as a key. Insert a key. You try a key, but the hole is circular and has no space for the key's teeth. Not that it could possibly have turned, of course. You look for something else to try, but you find nothing. Cast a spell. What could we cast? Knock? Is it actually a door? What is it? Dop? Ah! You cast a spell across the grooved wall in front of you, but nothing happens. Perhaps it's not a door after all. Or perhaps it is locked with a fearsome magic your spell cannot overcome? It is impossible to be sure. What else can we do? I'm using stamina up here. I assume this is fireball. Yeah, fireball is hot. How is psychic info safest escape? We've got sap. Why are we gonna cast sap? There's no foe here. At least I don't think there is. S-U-S is what again? I don't have these like memorized or something. Detect trap, best protective action. And then D, we only have that. Okay. Let me get more info here. I don't know why that's an option. It's not a perilous situation. Nah. I'm gonna leave. There's probably something here. We might be able to find something upstairs that might bring us back. You clamber out of the back out of the fireplace and into the study, no wiser for your explorations. See if we can go upstairs. Maybe there's a key thing there. Emerging from the fireplace, you make to brush yourself clean of soot, but find there is none. The fire crackles and spits, but strangely quietly for such a large blaze. Well, yeah, because it's not real. You head out of the room and back into the corridor. A chill breeze drifts from the stairwell. You place your foot on the first step of the stairwell, and suddenly it begins to move. Is it alive? Some kind of thin, flat beast? Or is it a trap? Uh-huh. Alright, guys. Here's your vote. Should I jump back? Should I get the hell out of this place? Should I stay still and try to balance myself? I guess I'm, like, trying to compensate for the moving of the stairwell? Or the step of the stairwell? Or should I grab the handrail? Who knows if it even matters? These two might achieve the same thing, but yeah. Post your comments below. Let me know what you think I should do next. How should I deal with this moving step? This moving stairwell step. So I'm hoping upstairs we find something awesome. Maybe some gold. Maybe an awesome item that we can sell will help us in our quest. Either one. But yeah, let me know what you guys think. Thanks so much for watching. See you in the next episode. And enduring, grow strong. See you next week.